This is August the 26th, 2014, and my name is Maureen Elizabeth Howard-Boiardi. I am the daughter-in-law of the famous Chef Boiardi that you find in the supermarket shelves. I am the widow of his only son, Mario Joseph Boiardi, who died in 2007. 2009, I found myself, unfortunately, with a house fire. And immediately the following day, I found that all doors, all offices, all people were closed to me. Nobody came. No lawyers, no insurance men, nobody. I tried to make sense out of this mess. I had been paying the mortgage on my house and I had not any arrears whatsoever. Finally, in desperation, after being told at least 52 times by lots of companies, "I'm very sorry, Mrs. Boiardi, I cannot speak to you. I don't have the authority to speak to you. We need to speak to your husband." I explained to them that my husband was dead and had been dead for almost 18 months. There was no way they could speak to my husband, and they hung up on me. In desperation, I called my husband's estate lawyer, Charlie Caputi, and I asked Charlie if there was anything at all that he could do to help me. And once again, I heard these words, "Don't be stupid, Maureen, they've made a mistake." Mr. Caputi called the company. And later, after many hours, I finally was told, "I believe that the mortgage company has shot themselves in the foot." My answer to that was, "I don't particularly care if they shoot themselves in the head. What does it do to me right now? I am standing in a house where nobody has come to assist me except my daughter from Great Britain and my son from California." I was then told not to spend or send the 3 months' checks that I had in my hand because I was going to the death of my sister in Wales. I asked why I shouldn't send these checks, and I was told, "This is not your house." I had been married for 25 years to a man. I had paid the deposit on a house. And there is not one person in this country that is so smart anywhere that can answer this question. Why did I lose my home? Why, when I paid my mortgage on time, why was I thrown out? Why did they turn their backs on me? I decided to try and fight, only to be told these words by lawyers on the eastern shore of Maryland. "Go home. There's nothing you can do." And I reminded them very nicely, "Gentlemen, I am home. The minute I put a piece of gold on my wedding finger and got married in this country, this is my home. It's been my home since 1983. And I don't ever recall my husband's accountants sending tax checks to Tony Blair or Margaret Thatcher." I was then told there was nothing I could do. I was also then told that nobody on the eastern shore of Maryland would assist me in this mess. They were too closely related. "Go across the bridge." And that's what I endeavored to do. I have waited 5 long years, but 2 years ago, when I finally returned home to Great Britain, exhausted, I left the remnants of what's standing behind me looking like a warehouse that any UPS would be proud of. Neatly stacked, cleanly labelled, and in pristine condition. My trial has taken almost 5 years to get here, And I arrived in this country in May this year to go to court. In July, I was told by my lawyer, the trial is off. The judge doesn't want to hear this. After being told by the judge to my face that she was going to come down and inspect this mess. Well, you know what, judge, I'm sorry. I really am. I respect your position. You've earned it. But I also have the right to the First Amendment, which means I have freedom of speech. And you made a mistake. You did. Even judges make mistakes sometimes. And you made one this time. You chose not to come to see this horror. I don't have that choice. I will deal with this. I really will. But last week I was told, after 5.5 years, the reason this mess is still here is because I committed arson. I burned my own house down. That's a lie. That's a lie. And for any one of you, anywhere in any country, should you ever get to hear this, you can wire me up. You can give me all the serum drugs you wish. I never burned my house down. But if you want to know why it's still here, call the insurance man. I'm not allowed to speak about this situation. I've been told I could go to jail. But Mark Free State, if you're listening, stand up, be a man, call your lawyer. And let the whole Eastern Shore know one thing, if nothing else. Maureen Boiardi did not burn down her house. Behind me are the ashes of my husband. He was a World War II veteran. And he was a career vet. You may ask at a later date why his ashes were in there. But they were in there safe. They're not there anymore. They've gone. The appraisers have come in. They have opened everything and they have just dumped everything. It is now my job and my duty to find my husband's ashes. I cannot and I will not allow anybody else in there besides myself to go through. They may assist, but we now have to do this box by box, sofa by sofa. Because somewhere, please, dear God, they're in there. But they're not where they were. And the pictures that you will see are not the pictures that I have, which are in Wales. I have the before and after pictures. The devastation that has been left for me to clean up is bad enough. When I left for Great Britain, everybody in Great Britain said to me, best of luck, Maure. Win or lose, best of luck. And I brought with me a little piece of paper because the day before I left, there was a young boy in Great Britain who died. He didn't have a chance. And his name was Stephen. And I brought this with me, Stephen. I brought you with me. All the way, Stephen. You have been by my side because I know if God had given you the will to have lived, you'd be right by me right now. Every day I put you in this book with another magnificent black lady who has given me inspiration. And one of the inspirations that I keep by my side every day says this: you may encounter many defeats, but you must not be defeated. In fact, it may be necessary to encounter these defeats so you can know who you are, what you can rise from, and how you can still come out of it all. She's my soul keeper. And to all you black, lovely ladies out there, forgive me if I borrow her, because you know what? I couldn't find anybody else. I really couldn't. This word, these two people have given this Welsh girl the strength to tackle what's in there. I will. I'll find his ashes if they're in this hovel of a mess, this horrendous mess that was left by appraisers who I have been told I can't get their names. Nobody wants to tell me who they are. Nobody. I have to find my husband's ashes. They're supposed to be laid at Arlington National Cemetery. And they're inside that mess somewhere, please, dear God. If they're there, listen to me, everybody. This Welsh warrior will find them. Believe you me, I will. But Eastern Shore, shame on you all. When you have your coffee in the morning or your gin and tonics at night, don't ever believe. When you sat at my dinner table, that I had the capability of burning down my home.
Broken glass that's on the floor is an antique baccarat vase. It was beautiful. And there it is, laying in pieces on the floor. This antique mirror here, all that was on that padded pallet on the back. Flap over flap. That is not the way to pack a box. Two corners in, two corners out, straight across the top. And this is how they repack the boxes after they find them. There's no stability in a box like this.